Now we will come to another problem where there is continuous fever for more than 3 days. There are no chills, but fever is continuous, reducing only temporarily for few hours with paracetamol or nimesulide. This is a situation where the doctor has to show concern. You may feel that 3 days is too short a period to think of prolonged fevers like typhoid. True, very true. But in general practice, if fever does not reduce within 3 days, before you change his antibiotic on the fourth day, the patient will have changed his doctor. I do not mean to say that you should change antibiotics frequently or investigate in a hurry. But this is where you have to be tactful. You should keep the patient and the relatives in confidence, show them your concern, and assure them that you will do all the needful investigations or referral to a physician if that is necessary. And if you feel that the patient is not keeping full faith in you or is over-anxious about his fever, then refer him to a physician before he suggests it. Even when the patient has full faith in you, there are always 10 people around him who will advise him to go to a specialist, though it may not at all be necessary. It is very important that you should recognize these psychological pressures and refer the patient to a physician in time before the patient starts doubting you. It is a tact that one has to learn to be successful in general practice. So with this fact in mind, if there is continuous fever for 4 to 5 days, you should ask for investigations. In particular, HBWBC platelet count, peripheral smear for malarial parasites, Vidal test and urine examination. And examine the patient clinically very thoroughly. Look for pallor, jaundice, palpate for liver, spleen and lymph nodes, auscultate the chest, examine the joints, leg edema and throat congestion. The antibiotic of choice would be a quinolone, ofloxacin or ciprofloxacin, or if the fever is very high, third or second generation cephalosporin, which will cover most fevers including enteric or typhoid fever. Now we will come to the importance of associated symptoms in case of fever. First is headache. If the patient of fever complains of headache, you should always test for neck stiffness. With the patient lying down on the examination table, flex the neck to touch the chin to the sternum. Neck stiffness indicates meningitis. There are other more common causes for headache like malarial fever, but the early cases of meningitis, which you may see once in 2-3 years, can only be detected if you have a habit, a reflex habit, of testing neck stiffness in every case of fever with headache. If there is neck stiffness, refer the patient immediately to a physician for lumbar puncture and CSF examination. If you give antibiotics and wait in this patient, then you are committing a blunder, because waste of time and delay in starting the correct antibiotics in meningitis can cause a lot of brain damage and cripple the patient for life. Another place where you should suspect meningitis is if the patient with fever is drowsy, restless, or behaves abnormally. Any change in the level of consciousness, drowsiness, or abnormal behavior with fever should make you suspect meningitis. A febrile patient who is restless in bed, tossing around in the bed, or talking and behaving abnormally should be suspected to have meningitis and neck stiffness should be tested for. All such patients should be referred to a physician early. When a patient with high-grade fever suddenly becomes unconscious or drowsy, there are three conditions which you should suspect: meningitis, encephalitis, and cerebral malaria. We have to do lumbar puncture and CSF study, rapid malaria test for P. falciparum, peripheral smear for MP, in addition to the routine investigations. In any case, such a patient should be treated by a physician and not the GP. If a patient of low-grade fever or minimal fever shows altered consciousness or altered behavior, then it is most likely to be a case of TB meningitis. So to summarize, if a patient comes with high fever and altered behavior, test for neck stiffness. If there is neck stiffness, refer him to a physician immediately. If there is no neck stiffness, give injection paracetamol, tab paracetamol 650 mg and a higher antibiotic. After the fever has come down, if the behavior becomes normal, then continue treatment under your care. But if the patient behaves abnormally even after becoming afebrile, then refer the patient. The third associated symptom could be cough. If a patient with fever has associated cough, then bronchitis and pharyngitis are the common causes. But if the fever is high, patient looks toxic with dyspnea and tachycardia, then you should think of pneumonia and ask for an X-ray chest and blood counts. If fever and cough are not severe, but they did not respond to a course of antibiotics for a week, then also you should ask for a chest X-ray to rule out tuberculosis. Next associated symptom could be joint pains. If a child or a young patient with fever has joint pains, look for undue tachycardia, chest pain or murmur. Think of rheumatic fever. Start penicillin and consult a pediatrician. If an adult patient complains of fever with joint pains, think of chikungunya. Start a NSAID and stronger analgesic. Now, if the fever is associated with splenomegaly, first think of malaria. Second differential diagnosis would be typhoid, and rarely you may come across leukemia. Blood tests will make the diagnosis clear. But if all blood tests are normal, then treat fever with splenomegaly as a case of malaria. Similarly, if the fever is associated with hepatomegaly, first look for jaundice of infective hepatitis. Secondly, think of typhoid fever. In both conditions, liver is soft and slightly tender. If liver is non-tender, you must rule out leukemia and ask for ultrasonography to rule out primary or secondary malignancy in the liver. Lastly, we will come to a patient who has fever continuously or on and off for a long period, say a month or so. Especially if the fever is on and off, its seriousness or long duration is often not realized as the patient continues to work in between the episodes of fever. Such long-drawn fevers need to be investigated in full details. HbWBC, peripheral smear, ESR, blood sugar, blood urea and serum creatinine, then Vidal test, Brucella test, TB IgM and IgG, test for HIV, X-ray of the chest, ultrasonography of the abdomen. These are some of the basic investigations. Tests of Vidal, X-ray chest may need to be repeated as necessary if there is no response to treatment. The prolonged fevers usually have some underlying generalized disease like tuberculosis or severe anemia, leukemia or lymphoma. So they must be carefully investigated, followed up or referred to a physician.